So, of course, I want to start by saying thank you, everyone, for joining. My name is Cody Armstrong, and today we're talking about the essentials of sheet metal. And the idea behind this webinar was really to put together a simple, short webinar that allows new users to Onshape to get the feel for the basics of sheet metal. So if you're new to Onshape or you're new to sheet metal design, this webinar is really intended for you to get kind of a grasp of how to create sheet metal parts, all the various ways that we have of creating sheet metal parts, and to answer a couple of the frequently asked questions that we get with regards to sheet metal parts. So sheet metal essentials is going to be a short webinar today. We're really going to focus on the various ways of creating sheet metal. And then I want to go through just a couple of frequently asked questions that we get with regards to sheet metal. Now, as I always say with these webinars, I really encourage you to ask any questions that you like. There's a questions dialogue in the GoToWebinar control panel. Feel free to ask any question, and I'll do my best to stop and address the questions as we go through today's webinar. So let's dig in. Now, the agenda is pretty straightforward. I'm going to give you a basic introduction into sheet metal design. So if you're new to sheet metal design, if you've never done any kind of sheet metal work before, I'll just give you a simple intro into why sheet metal is different than other types of, you know, CAD design, other types of solid modeling. So introduce you to sheet metal design. Then we're going to discuss where it's used. You know, where would you use Onshape sheet metal tools and where they apply. And then I want to get into the essentials. And of course, the essentials means how do I make a sheet metal part? What are the ways that I can make a sheet metal part? And as I always say, again, feel free to ask any question, and I'll do my best to answer them as we're going through today's webinar. It's going to be a short webinar. We're going to go through things pretty quickly here. So again, feel free to ask any question you'd like. All right, so let's get into it. Now, what is sheet metal design? So if you're new to designing in sheet metal, you know, of course, sheet metal design means you're designing sheet metal parts. But there's a few key requirements that sheet metal parts have that, you know, kind of rules that you have to design around. And when you're working with sheet metal, of course, that means you start with a sheet and you bend it into the appropriate shape. Now, that means that there are a few rules that sheet metal has to follow. The first is it must have uniform thickness. If you think of a sheet metal part, it's always the same thickness because, of course, you're starting with a sheet. So it has to have uniform thickness and it has to have a need to unfold. That's a very important step in the sheet metal process because you need to be able to go out and laser cut or water jet or whatever it is, this part that you've designed. So it needs to be able to unfold. It also needs to be able to determine the amount of stretch that you have in the design. And what I mean by stretch is every time that you create a bend in your sheet metal part, it stretches to a degree. And that stretch is determined by a factor we call K factor. So it's more than just uniform thickness and unfolding. It also has to accommodate for the amount of stretch that happens when you unfold. And that stretch can vary, and there's lots of math that goes into figuring out that amount of stretch, but it's a very important part of sheet metal design. You have to have that K factor so that you can accommodate all that stretch that happens in the design. Now, there's other things that make it just easy. Default bend radiuses, corner reliefs, bend reliefs, and other settings that just make sheet metal design very simple. But the key thing to keep in mind, again, is really the uniform thickness, the ability to unfold, and the ability to calculate that stretch in the form of a K factor. Those are really the key things that make sheet metal design different than, you know, solid modeling or surface modeling or any other kind of CAD modeling in general. It has those sets of rules. So that's a simple intro into sheet metal design. Now, what I'd like to do is get into the various ways that Onshape has to create a sheet metal part. Now, there are actually three ways to create a sheet metal part in Onshape. And I'm going to cover all three in just a moment, so if you bear with me. But in short, you can convert a solid part to sheet metal. That's one of the easiest ways, and I'll go over an example of that in just a bit. You can thicken a face. So I could select a series of faces and thicken them and create a sheet metal part from that. And of course, you can extrude an open profile. And I think if you've come from, you know, some other CAD application that has sheet metal tools, something like a SolidWorks, for instance, you're going to be very familiar with the process of extruding an open profile. I think that's the most common approach to sheet metal in other CAD applications. So again, three ways to start a sheet metal part: convert a solid, thicken a face, or extrude an open profile. So let's get into the three ways that we have. I'm going to discuss each one, and we're going to jump right into Onshape. We'll come back to our slides in just a second. But I want to keep it simple, and as I mentioned before, I want to show you the three ways that we have. And in this example, I'm designing a control box, and I essentially have just a really simple box shape with a lot of electrical components, electronics inside of this housing. And what I need to do is design a sheet metal part, a few sheet metal parts that hold these components. And that's a very common scenario where you need to design your sheet metal part around things that are attached to it. So you'll notice, if I show part one here, I already have a solid part that kind of defines the envelope that I want my sheet metal part to consist of. And that's really one of the common workflows is, okay, here's a solid. Now let's take this and convert it into a sheet metal part. And if you remember from the last slide, that's one of the techniques that we have for creating sheet metal. So in this example, I've already got a solid part. We can start right off in creating our sheet metal part. Now, if you haven't used sheet metal before, in the Part Studio on the far right of the toolbar, you'll find all your different sheet metal tools. The three ways that we have to create sheet metal parts are all done via one command, and that's this one right here, sheet metal model. It doesn't matter whether you're converting a solid, thickening a face, extruding a profile. This is the button that you'll click to do any of those things. So I click sheet metal model, and the sheet metal model command pops up. Now, I mentioned before there are three ways. You'll see those three at the very top. Convert a solid, extrude an open profile, or thicken a face. So those are the three techniques. And again, you're going to go to this same command every time you need to create a new sheet metal model and just choose the type of sheet metal that you want, right? Whether you want to extrude, thicken, or convert. Now, as I mentioned before, we have a solid part here. And I want to show you converting a solid to a sheet metal. It's very simple. You'll see the convert option, and it asks you what parts or surfaces do you want to convert? And well, I want to convert that one. So I just left-click the part in the graphics, and it says, okay, you want to convert this to sheet metal. Now, what it does is it automatically offsets all the faces in that part. And if you look really closely here, you'll see all these sheet parts or these sheet bodies that are attached to the outside faces of that part that I've selected. So it's already created the sheet metal, but it's done, you know, a whole series of different sheet metal parts. What I really want is bends between these two sheet metal bodies instead of separate sheet metal bodies. So the next step, once you've defined this is the part that I want to convert to sheet metal, is then to define what edges do you want to be bends. So in this example, I want, for instance, this edge to be a bend. So I left click that edge, and what you'll notice is now, instead of being two separate sheet metal parts, it's one sheet metal part with a bend that joins them, right? Now, I want a bend on the other side as well, so we'll rotate things around here, and I'll select this edge of the part. And instead of being now, you know, two different sheet metal parts, it's one with a bend that joins them. Now, it's intelligent enough to know, you know, if I were to select another edge, for instance, back here on the back side of the control box, well, now I need a relief, right? I need some kind of a corner relief to define, you know, the interaction between the sheet metal bends. And in this case, Onchip is intelligent enough to know once you select that edge, it will automatically add the relief that you need. So again, first step, define what part do you want to convert to sheet metal. Then go through and define what are the edges that are bends. In this case, it's these three edges along the bottom. And now we have one sheet metal part that's kind of the bottom piece of our housing here. Now, what I want to do next is define any faces to exclude. Now, you'll notice in this case, I'm not going to use these three faces in the same sheet metal part. This top half of the control box is going to be a separate sheet metal part. So I'm going to, in this case, exclude those faces. I'll click faces to exclude and then just left click those faces. And I'm just saying ignore those faces for this one sheet metal part. I can always come back and create a second sheet metal part for those, and we'll do that in a second. Now, a few other settings, a few other things that I want to mention with this command. I mentioned before, you know, you have options like your sheet metal thickness, your bend radius, your K factor, and what you're doing here is establishing a default setting for all the things going forward. So if you had a flange, you have any kind of other sheet metal functions to this part, it's going to have this K factor, this bend radius, and so on. So you're kind of establishing all of those default sheet metal settings for this part going forward here. You have minimal gap settings. You have what kind of corner relief type do you want as default? What kind of bend relief type do you want as default? And then the scale for those values. So again, think of this as you're establishing all those settings. We also have a clearance option. So if you wanted to offset your sheet metal part away from the part that you've referenced, you can do that. But the last thing I want to mention in this command is the option to keep the input part. By default, that block that I started with, that solid part that I started with, is going to go away once I create this sheet metal part, but I don't want that. I want to use that to create another sheet metal part. So I'm going to check keep input parts, and you'll notice it keeps that solid block that we started with. So I can hit the green check OK, and now we have our first sheet metal part. I'm going to hide that starting envelope, and you can see now we have our sheet metal design. Right? So that's our first sheet metal part, and we created it converting a solid part into sheet metal. And that's one of the first ways and a very common approach to sheet metal design, especially in cases like this where you're designing some kind of an enclosure, because it's very easy to model the solid and then just say, here's all the edges, here's all the faces, there's my sheet metal. Now, question. Will Onshape recognize that you can add a bin to convert the rear and side panels as well? Yeah. It will automatically add, in this case, the bin reliefs. If it joins in three different places, like the example I gave you before, you automatically get the corner relief in there. Forgive me if I'm misunderstanding the question. All right, so I've shown you one technique. That's just converting a solid, right? I take this solid part and I convert it into a sheet metal part. Now, the next technique that I'd like to show you is thickening a face. And I mentioned before, I want to create another sheet metal part, a separate sheet metal part that's the top half of this housing. So I'm going to go back to the sheet metal command. I'm going to choose the thicken option this time. So as I mentioned before, I choose thicken, and then instead of defining a single part, I'm defining faces that I want to thicken into sheet metal. Right? In this case, it's just this face, and that face. So I'm just clicking the three faces that I want to say this is going to be my sheet metal part that I want to thicken. And then again, just like converting a solid, I can say here's the edges I want to bend. And I just left click the edges, and it creates my sheet metal part. So now I have a second sheet metal part that's the top half of this housing. And I used the thicken option, right, thickening a face, to create that sheet metal part. Now, this has the same options as the past sheet metal model. So I have thickness, I have bend radius. If I needed to define a different K factor for this part or a different default bend radius or corner relief type, I can do that. Remember that you're establishing all those settings for that sheet metal part. So I can hit the green check OK, and now I have my second sheet metal part, and I used thicken to get it. Question, can the sheet metal go inside the solid instead of the outside? Yes. In the sheet metal model command, there's a reverse direction or opposite direction in the thickness option. And that will give you what you're looking for there. Question, I'm referring to the panel at the back where the fan is mounted. You should not be able to add a bin between the side and the rear panel. If you're referring to this as the rear panel, you can add a bin there. There's a corner relief cut because of it. You can add a bin that joins these two. That's the point of the corner relief. Now, bear with me for a moment here. I will get to a point where you can. What I want to point out, and I'll get to this in just a second, but you can see, it will allow you to create bins that are potentially overlapping, but you will be able to see that live in the flat view. So if that answers the question any better, you will be able to see if I create a combination of bins that isn't manufacturable, I can't get a flat out of it, I will immediately see it in the flat view. All right, so this is my first two techniques, right? We've created a solid, we converted it, then we grab the top three faces, thicken them to create a sheet. So now we've created two sheet metal parts. And that kind of consists of, you know, our basic housing, right? And we have two simple parts that reflect that housing. Now, what I want to do next is we're going to hide a few of these parts that we've created. And what I want to do is instead of referencing a face, instead of referencing a solid part, I want to extrude an open profile. Now, if we look at, if I hide all those outside components, all those control box pieces, and you can see I have a flange here, a simple extruded profile that I want to mount this power supply on. So this is an example where rather than referencing faces or parts, you're literally using open sketch profiles to define your sheet metal part. And this is a very common approach, especially if you've come from, a SolidWorks or Inventor or Creo or CATIA, one of those types of applications where you may be familiar with the process of sketching open profiles and literally extruding them to create sheet metal. So very simple, in the sheet metal command, right, I can choose the option to extrude. Now, keep in mind as we do this, I don't have to have any kind of reference data. I don't have to have edges of a model. You can reference those if you choose to, but you don't have to. And that's the main thing that I wanted to stress. Bear with me for a second here. So in this example, forgive me, my screen froze for a moment there. There we go. I think it should be live again. Okay, so in this example, I have, again, an open profile. I've gone to the same sheet metal model command. This is the same exact command that we've gone to in the two previous sheet metal parts. This time, though, we're going to choose the option to extrude. So it's a bit different. We're not choosing convert or thicken. We're extruding sketch profiles. Now, a tip is you can select individual pieces of the sketch and create a sheet metal from that, or especially if you have more complicated sketches, you can just choose the entire sketch from the feature list. It's a very simple way of selecting everything in the sketch. But that's really it. You choose your open sketch profile, and it extrudes it, really no different than a normal extrude command. The key thing that I would stress here is notice in my example, I did not sketch in the bins, right? So to make this clear again, notice this is the sketch I'm starting with. Sharp corners. Onshape automatically adds the bins in so that you don't have to worry about that. And that's one thing that gets asked quite often. Do I sketch in the bins? And the answer is no. Create those sharp corners. Onshape will automatically put the bins based on the bin radius that you define. So in this example, it's really no different than an extrude except for that case where it's adding those radiuses in. We have the same options as we would a normal extrude. I can choose something like a symmetric. We can define our depth here, let's say 90. And now we have a simple sheet metal extruded part. Now, again, very similar to the past two sheet metal parts that I've created, I have thickness options, I have bend radius options, I have K factor options, minimal gap options, corner relief options. And again, I'm just establishing all of those default settings for this sheet metal part going forward. So I can hit the green check, and now I have a third sheet metal part in my control box example. So I've shown you all three ways to create a simple sheet metal part. You have convert a solid, thicken a face, or in this example, extruding an open profile. So those are the three techniques that we have for creating sheet metal parts, but then of course that's not the only tools that we have for sheet metal. Now, I want to jump back to my slide deck. Just bear with me for 1 second here. And I want to go over a few things that a lot of sheet metal users ask how to do. And one of the first things that I always like to mention is in the folded and flat view, you can select in either place and it will update automatically. You can also select in the table view and we'll select the edge or the radius automatically. So you can make any change anywhere in all three places and they automatically update. Now the question was asked earlier, what if I chose a combination that can't unfold? You would immediately see that in the flat view. You would see overlapping edges with a big red, indicator that this is not unfoldable, right? It won't allow you to unfold. It will overlap if you try. Now, I haven't mentioned this yet, but we're going to get into it in just a second. The flat view and the table view are very important pieces of the interface. And what I'm trying to point out here is if you select an edge on the flat view, it will highlight that same edge in the folded model. If you select a joint in the table view, it will highlight that joint in the folded and the flat view. So no matter what you select in either of the three places, it highlights in the other two. So let me give you an example of this. Let's jump back into our sheet metal part. Now, the sheet metal table in flat view, you'll find the icon in the far right corner of Onshape. So in the Onshape environment here in the graphic space, once you have a sheet metal part, you'll see this icon appear. I select that icon and it loads the sheet metal flat view and table. How do you select the line you want to extrude on? You can left click the line in the graphics if it's just one, or you can select the sketch from the feature list. Either will work just fine. So you can just left click individual lines in the graphic space and it will extrude those. Or if you just want to extrude the entire sketch, select the sketch in the feature list. All right, so the sheet metal, flat view, and table allow you to see dynamically your flat views, right? So if we bring back some of these parts, the flat view that you're seeing here is our first sheet metal part. And you'll notice as I highlight an edge, it highlights the corresponding edge in the folded view, right? If I zoom in and grab a bend here, it's going to highlight that bend in the folded view. So it's very easy for me to see the flat, see the folded, and understand, you know, how the two correlate, right? Now, this also means that if I make a change, it dynamically updates in the flat view. So if I decided to add an additional edge here, and all of a sudden it can't unfold, you're going to see that in bright red over here. You're going to see immediately that I have a conflict. I don't have to like suppress a feature or flatten the model. It's a dynamically updating thing. So if I were to go in and add an edge that caused some kind of a conflict, I would immediately see that conflict in the flat view. I would see overlapping geometry and know that I have some kind of an issue. But again, the main thing I wanted to stress here is if you're curious about an edge, you're curious about how the flat view corresponds with the folded, or you're curious about what a joint is, you know, what is joint B in this example? Well, if you mouse over it, it highlights. So you can mouse over an edge in the folded model, the flat model, or the table, and the other two will automatically highlight. So it's just an easy way to identify what's what in your sheet metal design. So the flat view is on the bottom half. We have the table view in the top half. And if I mouse over, for instance, joint B and left click it, notice now that joint is highlighted in my folded model. And this becomes really important if you do any kind of work where you may have, you know, non-standard bend radiuses, or maybe I do, you know, multiple bend radiuses and not just one throughout my sheet metal design. It's really easy to identify an edge just by left clicking it, right? It will show you that in the graphics. Question. I misunderstood your previous question. What I mean is, if you want to choose the top or the bottom of the sketch, in the example it defaulted to the top of the sketch, what if I wanted to get the extrusion to flow to the bottom line of the sketch? And that's very similar to the question that was asked earlier. You have an option for opposite direction. And that will essentially flip the side that it's creating the sheet metal part on. I believe that's what you're asking. Forgive me, I misunderstood your previous question. But this is the same option that you saw in Convert. And thicken. You have that opposite direction and will flip where the sheet metal part's created relative to the geometry that you're extruding. So you'll see this option next to thickness in all of those settings, and it allows you to do just that. Flip the flow to the bottom side of the sketch line as opposed to the top. All right, so again, keep in mind if you select a joint in the table, it selects it in the folded and the flat view. Notice here, that same joint is highlighted. If you select a joint in the flat view, let's grab this edge right here. It highlights it in the table and it highlights in the folded view. So it's very easy to identify what's what in your sheet metal part. So that's one of the commonly asked questions that we get. How do I know what joint B is? Or how do I know that when I add this particular feature that it's right in the flat? And you can see everything update instantly in this flat view. All right, so that's the sheet metal table and flat view, a very important part of Onshape sheet metal experience. The thing that I always like to stress here is you're not, you know, if you come from other CAD systems, you may be familiar with flatten, where you have to make a change, then flatten it and see if it works. In Onshape, if you make a change, you instantly see if it works because you have that real-time updating flat view. So you don't have to go back and forth between a flatten and folded state. You can see them both at the same time. Question, how are you determining which sheet metal part is in the flat view? Very good question. So at the very top, of this sheet metal table in flat view, you have a drop down. Now, if you just have one sheet metal part, of course, it's going to be very obvious. But in my example, I have three, and I can choose which one I want to look at. So there's the top half of our control panel, and there's the extruded profile that we've created. So very good question. If you have more than one sheet metal part, you have the drop down that allows you to choose it. How would you create a flat view for a sheet metal part that's shaped like a cone? And the short answer is today you can't. There are workarounds that allow you to accomplish this, but there's no dedicated function today that allows you to unroll a cylinder or a cone. I will say, if you're really interested in pursuing workarounds, there's a public model called square to round that covers a square to round transition, but it would be a very similar technique for a cone. That is something that we're working on, so we're aware of the need to unroll, you know, those kinds of shapes, but it's not there today. We don't have the ability to unroll a cylinder or a cone without a pretty substantial, you know, workaround. If you're interested in pursuing that, check out the square to round public model. You know, there is an example of that. Question, will you be adding flanges for attaching the top to the bottom? You certainly can. I'm going to create a flange in just a moment, so bear with me here. Is there anything for drawn or formed features or formed beads? You can absolutely do that. I'm going to cover that in a bit. There's no dedicated commands for it, but it's very easy to model in once you've finished the sheet metal part. Question, will you add holes for components, switch, readout, connector, screws, etc.? Yes. You can use just the normal hole feature, just like you would in a solid part. So if you just need to add simple holes in your part, I'd recommend using the hole feature. You could, of course, just sketch circles and extrude cut. That works just as well as well. If you need bosses, you know, if you need things that stick out from the sheet metal that kind of violate the minimum thickness, think of those operations that you would do after you've laser cut the part. You know, I laser cut the part and then I weld in a gusset, or I weld in a standoff, or I do something like that. Then I would finish the sheet metal. I'm going to cover this in just a second, but I would finish the sheet metal before I did those operations, right? Think of any kind of operation where you would do it after the laser cutting, then you would want to do that after you finish the sheet metal. I say laser cut, but water jet, I think you get the idea there. Any type of, you know, flat that you're cutting. Would these drawn formed features be able to flattened in the flat view? No, no. Any kind of drawn or formed feature is not going to be in the flat view. And I think most people don't want to see that in the flat view because that's not a part of the laser cutting operation. In fact, in many situations, it will confuse the software that generates, you know, the toolpath for the water jet or the laser cutter. But you can absolutely do that. It's just not in the flat view. It's visible afterwards. So bear with me. I will get to, you know, a better explanation of some of these questions. All right, so let's move on. Now, the question came up earlier. If I wanted to add a flange and then change the length of the flange, how would I go about doing that? It's very simple to add a flange. You left-click an edge, and it creates a flange. But it creates a flange the full length of the edge, and you may not necessarily want that. So the answer to this is just to use a simple move face, grab the face and drag it to the position that you want. The key thing to keep in mind here is Onshape knows that you're working on a sheet metal part and will automatically add the bend or corner reliefs that you need to create that move face operation. So you don't really have to worry about, am I going to have to manually create, you know, that relief? So let me give you an example of this. Let's go back to our third sheet metal part. Bear with me here. In fact, let's just hide everything else. So let's hide all the other parts. So this is that third sheet metal part that we were working on. And what I want to do is create flanges on either end that allow me to kind of hold that power supply in place. Now, flange itself is not a terribly difficult command to create. You select the flange command from the toolbar, and you left-click an edge. It doesn't matter whether it's the inner or outer edge. It's just a matter of left-clicking that edge and then defining the details for your flange. In this case, we'll go the opposite direction, which means I want it to come up, and I want the distance to be, say, 15 millimeters. Now, there's other options here. If I want to align the flange to the inside or the outside, there's options there as well. And then, of course, I can define the end of the flange up to a point or something along those lines. But I've created my flanges just with simple edge selections. Notice that the relief is automatically cut into the part for that. But let's just say that I'm not satisfied with the length of these flanges and I want to cut them back. I only want a short section for them. It's very easy for me to do something like a move face, click the end face of the flange, and then just grab and drag it, right? What you'll notice is Onshape automatically recognizes this is a sheet metal part. Therefore, if you're doing this kind of an operation, we need to make sure that we have the bin relief in there, right? And I can do this on either face. In fact, I can do them both at the same time if I want, and then cut those flanges back to the appropriate size. If I wanted to cut both back, I could very easily, and give me that flange that only extends for a certain length, right? So that's an easy way to change the length of the flange, and that's a commonly asked question. I create a flange, but I select the whole edge, and I don't want to flange the whole length of the edge. How do I change that? And that would be the move face command. All right, so question. Can you link the thicknesses to properties? No, not yet. It's not linked. You could, of course, create a property and then type in the thickness, but that's not a linked parameter. What is the relief cut size based on? Did Onshape use a standard based on material thickness? It's a scale factor based on the material thickness, yes. So it is dependent on the material thickness as well as other conditions as well, but it is a scale factor. You're not entering in like a diameter, for example. All right, next thing I wanted to discuss, reordering the bins in sheet metal table. Now, the question often comes up, why would I bother with this? And I think this is particularly important if you do any kind of in-house manufacturing or you're the person making this part, because it allows you to reflect the manufacturing intent, not just the design intent, but the manufacturing intent of the model. And this becomes important, you know, 6 months down the road when I come back to this model and I want to know, how did we make this? You know, what order did we do the bins? Oftentimes with more complicated sheet metal parts, bin order is an important factor. What order do you do the bins? And you can reflect that. You can put that information right into the Onshape document. This is something I've seen a lot of other users do. They'll do screenshots and they'll have a PDF that shows them the bin order and things like that. This is an example where I can build all of that right into the document. The neat thing about this is if I make a design change, that bin order is still reflected. I don't have to go out and create a new PDF or grab a bunch of new screenshots. I can do all of this right inside the document. Now, it's pretty straightforward. In this example, we have our, you know, simple housing or flange here. And what I want to do is say, well, this is the first bin that should happen, right? Joint B here. I can right-click and move up. And now that's the first bin in the list. You know, and I can move up and down by just simply right-clicking the thing I want to move up and down in the list. And what you'll get is the ability to say, here's the bin order, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then I can see if I left click that, okay, that's the first bin, that's the second bin. And you can start to, you know, kind of build out the order that you're going to do these bins. Again, this becomes really important if you're actually making this part, or if you have some kind of a, you know, in-house manufacturing where you want to be able to capture that bin order so that you can reuse it in the future. Right, so that I know the order. If I come back to this 6 months later, I know this is the way it was made. Question, how would you handle standard material thickness? For example, when you use an external software like SigmaNest, hence the reason to link the properties to the thickness. Well, you can enter standard material thicknesses into your sheet metal command. It's just a matter of entering in the decimal value for the sheet metal thickness. Of course, that carries over to SigmaNest because it's a solid model. So I'm not sure I 100% follow the question. You can enter in a, you know, a standard thickness. It's not a gauge thickness. You'd have to figure out the gauge to decimal equivalent, but then you would just type in that value. It depends on if you're exporting a DXF to SigmaNest or if you're importing solid models in a SigmaNest. I could see a difference there. But it should be fairly straightforward in SigmaNest to define the thickness as well. If you're doing the DXF and not a solid model. All right, so that is reordering the bins in the sheet metal table. I think particularly important if you're actually making it or if you have some kind of in-house manufacturing where you want to capture that in the document and you want to be able to reuse it. You want to be able to come back to it. Now, This is the question that comes up very often. In fact, it's already been asked once or twice here in this webinar, is what about louvers? What about feed? What about standoffs? What about those things that I do after I laser cut or water jet the part, whatever it is, right? After I cut the part, I want to be able to weld in bosses. I want to be able to weld in louvers or weld in standoffs or press in, you know, all these different types of operations that happen after the cutting operation. And the answer to this is finish sheet metal. Essentially, you can do anything that you want to a sheet metal part after it's been finished. The key there is you can't extrude a boss on a sheet metal part before it's been finished. Because again, sheet metal parts need to have uniform thickness, they need to have the ability to unfold, and all of that's very important to how Onshape behaves in terms of sheet metal. But you really wouldn't want to see extruded bosses in a flat view, right? That doesn't help me in manufacturing the flat, right? I just want the profiles that I'm going to cut in the flat, and then I can, you know, position the points or whatever it is to weld in my standoffs later. So again, the key thing is, you can do anything that you want to a sheet metal part. You can extrude bosses. You can do all that stuff as long as you've finished the sheet metal model. And just think of those, any type of those operations where after it's cut, maybe even after it's bent, I weld in this or I add this. You know, I punch this boss in or something to that effect. You know, whether it's a louver or a standoff or something like that, they all really kind of follow that same workflow. Now, finished sheet metal is pretty straightforward. If I go into our sheet metal part here and, you know, I choose, by the way, on the far right of the toolbar, you'll see it right here, finish sheet metal model. If I choose finish sheet metal model, I left click my part. I now have finished the sheet metal model and I can do anything that I want to it, right? So if I start a sketch, and forgive me for the quick sketch here, but if I wanted to add a standoff, for instance, let's do a standoff of 20 by 10, right? And we'll add a few dimensions because, of course, we need to define things properly here. So I go through and add a few dimensions, kind of constrain things, no different than I would any other normal extruded feature. Again, once you finish sheet metal, it's no different than any other part. And I can extrude, okay. And now I have an extruded boss on my sheet metal part. Again, this could be a louver, it could be a flange, it could be anything that you want. As long as you've finished the sheet metal, you're good. Now, the next question that gets asked is, well, is this going to show up in the flat view? And again, the answer is no, right? That's deliberate because, again, this is something that I'd want to see after I cut the part, right? So any kind of finished sheet metal, anything you do after finished sheet metal doesn't show in your flat view. And that's a deliberate choice because, again, you know, this kind of stuff can actually cause issues when we go to actually manufacture. So that's, again, finished sheet metal, very important part of, you know, designing sheet metal parts. If you have any kind of, you know, post-processing operations you do to your sheet metal parts, like louvers, like gussets and those types of things, finished sheet metal is going to be key. So I have one final thing, and this is probably the most commonly asked question. How do I take this sheet metal part, the flat view, and export it to DXF? Of course, the DXF is very common if you work with laser cutters or water jets or nesting software. Another very common thing. I need to nest these parts together and then cut a whole bunch of them at once. And the answer is you can right-click a flat view and export to DXF. So you don't have to do any kind of special steps. You don't have to worry about scale or creating a drawing. All you do is right-click the view, and you'll see the option to export. Again, right-click the flat view in the flat view on the right. Right? Right-click that flat view, choose export, choose your format, choose your version, all those things that you'd like, hit export, and that will save a DXF to your local machine that you can run out to, you know, generate toolpath for or put into a nesting software, whatever it is that you're trying to do. But again, you know, this is kind of that final step. Maybe the drawing would be the final step, but, you know, to actually manufacture it, this is a very important, you know, one of the last steps that you'll need, and that's sending it out to actually have it made. So whether you're nesting it or you're just sending one off to have it cut, chances are you're going to need a DXF. At least commonly, you're going to need a DXF. So I hit export, it saves it to my local machine, and I'm off and running, right? So that's what I had planned for you. I know it's a quick intro into sheet metal, but what I want to do is kind of give you an intro on how to create basic sheet metal parts and then answer a few of the commonly asked questions. Now, I see a few questions that are left, so bear with me. I am going to stick around and make sure to answer all of them. But I want to say thank you, everyone, and ask any questions you like. I'll make sure to stick around and answer them, but that's what I had. Thank you and have a good day.